interesting set of greetings. And the thing that I was struck by as I read them again and again and again was it's really all about identity. Who we think we are or who the world thinks we are. There are several characters in this narrative that we read, two chapters out of the Gospel of John, several people that display one set of characteristics and act out a totally different one in our narrative tonight. The first one is Peter, right? Peter, model disciple, leader of this ragged band of 12, but the man who denies Christ three times. The man that we think is the model disciple and the person that all of us should be like is the man who seems to now have no faith at all. He's running away from that person and the ideas that he's been following for the last 3 years. And then there's the Jewish high council or the Jewish high priest, people who are supposed to be upholders of the law, people who are supposed to know what it is to do right and know when it is to do wrong and know the difference and not do the latter, right? These are the people who are supposed to know what they're supposed to do and do it all the time. Yet these are the people who are trying to get Pilate to crucify a man who they know is innocent because they want to get rid of him. Because he's exercising power over them. So they twist the laws to get their own way by calling for Pilate to release Barabbas, a known criminal, someone who has broken the law. This is not something that people who uphold the law should be doing. And then there's Pilate, right? Pilate is the Roman governor, the Roman prefect. He's the person in this area who should have the power, right? And three times in our reading tonight, it says that Pilate came out to the high council and said, I find no reason to condemn this man. I find nothing wrong with him. He's done nothing wrong. Three times. Then at the end, what does he do? He hands Jesus over to be crucified. Because he ultimately has no power. Because he knows that if he didn't do what the people wanted, that he would be in trouble. It's all about identity. And who we think we are, and who the world thinks we are. This night that we call Good Friday, why do we call it Good Friday? The day that our Savior died, we try to look for hope. We look to the leader of this ragged band of disciples and see that he's turned his tail and tucked it and ran away. There's no faith at all in Peter. The high priests are calling for the death of a man that shouldn't be killed. And the man that has power in this place to do what is right and knows what is true doesn't even do it. Why is it good? Where is the hope? There's two more people in this story still. Well, at least two. There's many more than that. There's two people, one of which is our hope. In those last four verses that I read, it talked about Joseph of Arimathea, a disciple of Jesus who was a Jew. He was a secret disciple of Jesus. Because he was afraid of what was going to happen to him. He was actually probably part of the Jewish leadership. And then the person that is our hope, Nicodemus. Nicodemus comes with Joseph of Arimathea bringing spices and different things, weighing about 100 pounds so that they can prepare Jesus' body. Nicodemus, if you remember back in John chapter 3, was the Pharisee who came to Jesus under the cover of darkness because he didn't want anybody to know that he was coming to Jesus. In John chapter 7, Nicodemus speaks out for Jesus in front of the Jewish high council because, you see, Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He was in on the Jewish high council meeting. And when they were talking about wanting to get rid of him and to destroy him and remove him, Nicodemus spoke. in Jesus' defense. And here we see him bringing a known criminal down off the cross. That is hope. Why? Because a man that shouldn't be believing in this Messiah, who came to him questioning him, moved from the path of coming to him under darkness to speaking publicly for him, to then coming out in public and helping remove him and place him in a tomb to give him the proper burial. That's the movement of a disciple. That's the movement of someone who believes in the fact that Jesus is what he said he was going to be. That is someone who believes in the fact that even now when we lay Jesus in the tomb, that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that in 3 more days we're going to see him again. In the darkest moments of our hours, in the darkest moments of our lives, Nicodemus shows us how we can hope and know that even when Jesus is in the tomb, that the promises are still going to hold true.